thank you. My honor to be here. It's a pleasure. We'll begin with this. You know this. That's our planet. Actually, you don't know it because most of it's unexplored. This is the way we look at the ocean when we're an oceanographer at this planet. It's more than 70% covered with ocean. Average depth is between around 2.5 miles, 4 kilometers, something like that. This is the Pacific Ocean, a view from space of the Pacific Ocean. You see almost no continent, almost no land at all. It's wide, it's vast, it's deep, it's hostile. And as I said, most of this planet's covered with it, yet it's almost totally unexplored. We've explored about 5% of the oceans. That means we're living on a planet that's mostly unexplored. And when you think about the ocean, this is the way most people think about the ocean, the beach. It's wonderful, it's great, but it's not the ocean. It's the edge of the ocean. And it's the one that most of us know and most of us are familiar with. But over the horizon, it's not like that. And you know, this is the way we used to draw over the horizon for the ocean when we made our maps. Monsters live there. It's a very strange place. And I love this picture because this idiot on the boat shooting at this monster, probably not a good idea. At the very best, he's going to irritate the monster. But, you know, we make monsters today, still in the ocean. The sharks, this was a smiling, happy shark, but it looks fairly ferocious to us. And animals that are very mythological still. They're fantastic from fantasy. The narwhals look like that. I never knew that they even existed until about 10 years ago or 15 years ago, and there they are. Here's an image, though, I want you to look at. You see this is some water lit up. It looks like a nighttime view lit from where you're sitting onto the water. And you see the water, you see the white sands, you see rocks on the side, and I'll zoom in a little bit closer. And then you see the waves in the water. The important thing is that this water that you're looking at is actually at the bottom of the ocean. So when we go into that ocean, when we explore that 5%, we find amazing things. We find lakes beneath the sea. So this water is super dense, and actually the submarine looking at it could land on that water and float around on that water, but couldn't sink into it. It's an amazing thing. And when we look at the Earth, this is the Atlantic Ocean beyond the Pillars of Hercules. There's a mountain out there, a mountain range, and it's called the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. It's got many, many thousands, actually, of peaks higher than the Alps and greater than some of the mountains and some of the peaks in the Himalayas. It's got thousands of valleys that cross it, wider than any of the great valleys on Earth. It's got rivers. We call them currents, but they also are at the bottom of the sea, these currents. We find currents in that. We even find waterfalls. The greatest waterfall on Earth, in fact, is between Iceland and Greenland. It's about 5 times higher than Angel Falls in Venezuela. So we find rivers. We find mountains. We find lakes, as I said. We find all these things, and at 5% we explore it. I want to give you another look at this mountain range, because it actually is not just in the Atlantic Ocean, but extends around the entire world. It's 50,000 miles long, 70,000 kilometers long. It's the most significant and dramatic ocean topographic feature on Earth, yet we don't know it at all. We've hardly visited that world. So, you know, to explore in that world, it takes technology. You can't go to a rental, car rental, Hertz, Avis, and say, I want to go to the bottom of the ocean. We have to build that technology. And it's very difficult. We can't use GPS. We have to bring our own power. There's no radio waves. We have to communicate with sound. So it's much more difficult than you can imagine. So it's been slow to explore that 5% of the Earth that we've done so far. And it always, as always, it takes people. And you know, to me, the heroes are not always the person standing on stage giving you the news. It's the people on board the ships. It's always been that way. People on board ships, understanding how to work with nature. So here's the planet again. And you know, the thing about the, oh, I'm sorry, can we have the, let's go on a dive into the deep, and can we have the first video, please? This is a little bit of technology, not robots, but a very dramatic way to explore the ocean. It's with a submarine, and this is the submarine Elvin. I'm at the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution, and we operate this submarine. 3 people inside that submarine being pulled out on the deck of a ship. And they're all wondering the same very profound thing. Should I have gone to the bathroom one more time? It's a very long day. 3 people in a very tiny space. And the bathroom, the only bathroom is a bottle. And yes, you're nervous, but as soon as the submarine hits the water, this point here, it's incredible. That lovely color blue penetrates inside the submarine. The sounds of the surface ship fade away. You start to hear the sounds of the sonar, that ping, down to the bottom and back. You hear sometimes dolphins, sometimes whales. The diver says okay to dive, and down you go. It's a 2.5-hour trip to the bottom. In the first half an hour, you go through the blue, light blue, deep blue, dark blue, and then for 2 hours, pitch black. Next slide, next video, please. And we thought for a long time that because it was black and dark, there would be no life. But now when we go into that world, that dark world of the ocean, we find fantastic life. This is a sort of a jellyfish. This one's only about 8 inches long, but it's got all sorts of working parts, very complicated. Fully grown, it could be the width of the stage, would be the length of the stage would be that jellyfish. So it's a huge animal. And yet if you tried to collect it, it would fall apart. We used to try to pull a net through the ocean and then with microscopes look at this body parts and mush that we would pull up and try to understand what these animals look like. But now we know better. You can't do that. You have to actually go there to explore. So we'll keep going to the bottom. Next, please. And at the bottom of the ocean, we find the record of human history. And sometimes the record of human history comes in big chunks. Titanic's one of those. And Titanic's a fantastic ship, a great story. Here's the bow of Titanic, and this is where Jack, of course, was king of the world at that spot. We visited there many times. The thing about Titanic is when it sank, we would commit, and other ships like Titanic, we commit the souls and the ship for eternity to the deep. But now with our technology, here we are. Not just to make movies, but because every single year, about 14 ships on average, the size of Titanic, sink. And today we need to go there to find out for the families of the crew, for the shipping industry, for the insurance companies, why do these ships sink? Titanic, we understood. These we never did. This is the top of that mountain range. And that was hot water coming out, very poisonous hot water coming out of the seafloor. And we said there should be absolutely no life at all there. But instead, we find incredible amounts of life, all of it very, very strange, almost alien life. You saw things called tube worms. These are shrimp, all living off of chemical energy coming out of the earth. Never predicted, almost impossible to believe. And there's big animals, too. This is an octopus that if you stretch him out, he's about four feet across. All different kinds of octopuses live there. So pretty an amazing world. But it's not just the deep ocean. Even in shallow water, we're surprised. That's a barracuda looking for an octopus for lunch. And I have a friend named Roger Hanlon who studies octopuses, how they can camouflage themselves. And I'll tell you, there's a large octopus hiding in this image. And here comes Roger observing, and you'll see him in a moment. Voila, there he is, that's his eye. And watch what happens, he gets scared, he throws up a cloud of ink, and off he goes, and Roger swims very fast and catches up. And the octopus, of course, tries to bluff by making his eye spot very big. But the amazing thing is we're going to run backwards and look at this beautiful animal. And it's hard to believe that that animal on the right, with smooth skin, light skin, can turn into that stuff on the left. That's what Roger studies, and it's amazing how that happens. But here he goes. And this is slow motion, mind you. So in full motion, very fast. I mean, amazing that it can do that. So next. So what? The Earth's an exciting place to explore. And, I told you that we find all these. We find mountains. We find rivers. We find lakes. We find incredible amounts of life. We look at Titanic. That's all exciting stuff, but it's also important stuff. You know, in the daytime Earth from space, you can hardly see 7 billion people. We live there. But at nighttime, we light up just like the jellyfish. There we are. That's humanity at night. That's the Earth at night. And there's many different kinds of light. Actually, there's four different kinds, and we'll step through them. This is North America. The white lights are the lights of electricity. And you can see the major cities, New York, San Francisco, Los Angeles. Here's Europe. Same thing's true. You can see the outline of Europe perfectly well. Even though it's not a map that's lit here, this is just done with lights from space, you can see Europe perfectly well. You can see Greece, you can see Spain, Italy, England, Scotland, Scandinavian countries. The red dots, those are flares from oil exploration. And that's Siberia that you see there in the upper right, and you can see Persian Gulf down here in the lower right. But those are second type of lights. I'm not going to show you the third type is fishing fleets, which are amazing. We see fishing fleets all over the world now, and we've done a very good job at catching most of the fish, which is a very serious problem because the big fish, the fisheries, have collapsed as far as we can tell. We need to understand better what's going on. But here, this is important to me. You know, that's Africa. And what you see on top is the Sahara, not much going on there. But the golden dots, the yellow dots that you see here, those are village fires. These are people that are burning solids mostly for light, for heat, for food, for energy, not so much electricity. And what amazes me is that from here up through the Middle East and into China, there's about 1 billion people on this planet, Poseidon's planet, 1 billion people that are clinging to the edge of life for lack of one thing, fresh water. So how is that possible on a planet that we said was there was so much water? You know, and why do oceanographers study that? Why are you worried about people with fresh water? Well, I'll tell you why. This is all the water on the planet Earth. We took all the water off. And when you do that, the ball on the left is all the water that's on Earth. Every ocean drained dry, all the glaciers, all everything. So if the Earth was the size of a soccer, as a size of a football, all the water would fit into a ping pong ball. That doesn't seem right because I said there's so much water, but when you think about it, the Atlantic Ocean is 3,000 or 4,000, depending on where you measure it, thousands of miles across, but 2 miles deep. 2 miles is a lot, but when you think of it on the planet scale, 4,000 by 2, it's thinner than paint. It's thinner than the frost on a glass. So that's all the water on Earth. The ball on the right, the next one, is all the fresh water that includes the glaciers and the rivers and all. And the tiny little speck to the right of that, that's the fresh water that's readily available for us to drink, for farms, for us to do the things that we're used to doing and take for granted for the most part. That's it. That's all that's ever made on this planet. For us to survive the way we do, we need to take that little tiny bit of fresh water and sprinkle it in just the right places, in just the right amounts, in just the right time of year. Our whole society's collapsed. It's happened many times in the past. It's an incredibly sensitive system, and it's controlled mostly by the ocean. So when you see this image again of Earth, you know, we take it for granted. All the technology that went into giving us this image, there's nothing that guarantees us as a species that we can get off the planet, look back on where we live, and just take it for granted the way we do. It's an incredible privilege to do that. And you know, one of the things is that we think this image makes us think we understand it all, and we don't. We don't. And our life depends on it. This is home. The oceans are limited. The atmosphere is limited. You know, the oceans provide us with three important things. The air we breathe, about every breath of air, fresh air you take, you can thank the ocean for that oxygen. The food we eat, 1 billion people get their food from the ocean, directly from the ocean. And the water we drink, more than 90% of the rainfall on this planet is controlled where it rains, how much it rains, controlled by the ocean. You would think we would be smart enough, given those three things that we now know, that we would begin to understand the ocean and begin to use it wisely. Instead, we don't. We think we understand it. We want to take action. And if we're not careful, we will love this planet to death. So it's important to make changes, sure. It's important to recognize that this planet has always changed since its very beginning. The face of the Earth changes. Earthquakes and volcanoes prove that. And the climate changes. And we've added to that change. We've made it a little bit more complicated than the natural rhythms of cycles. But you know what? The answers are out there. And if we try a little harder, if we make up our minds, we can understand this planet, learn to live with it better. I'll leave you with a quote from Marcel Proust. He said, "The true voyage of discovery is not so much in seeking new landscapes, which we do, but in having new eyes." And the challenge we have today is with new technology. For the first time, we can explore and understand the oceans. The challenge to us is to take that information, little data, big data, and use it wisely. Thank you very much. Thank you.